Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day.
Chaitanya Brahma Jive Daya Kare Shaparshada Shiya Dhamma Shagayava Tari Shaparshada Shriya Namaha Sahaya Matare
Shaparshada Shriya Dhamma Shagaya Vatari
Shaparshada Shriya Namaha
Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Jive Daya Kari
Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Jive Daya Kari
अतंत दुर्लभ प्रेम करिबारे दान
अतंत दुर्लभ प्रेम करिबारे दान
शिखाय शरणागति Bhakatera Prasad
Shikhaya
Dhanayatma Nivedana
Nibedana Gopritya Marana
Dhanayatma Nibedana Gopritya Marana
Dhanayatma
Shivē Krishna Vishāsapāla Avasara Kivē Krishna Vishāsapāla Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Jīve Daya Kari
Chaitanya Prabhu Jive Daya Kare
Bhakti Anukula Matra Karjera Shikar
Bhakti Anukula Matra Karjera Shikar
Bhakti Anukula Matra कार्जेर शिकार भक्ति भक्ति प्रति कुल भाव वर्जन अंगीकार भक्ति प्रति भाव वर्जन अंगीकार भक्ति प्रति कुल भाव वर्जन अंगीकार
भक्ति प्रति कुला भजन कर
सरंग शरणागति होई बेजा सरंग
शरणागते
होई बेजा सरंग शरणागति होई बेजा
सरंग शरणागते
তাহার প্রার্থনা শুনে শ্রীনন্দ
কুমার শ্রীনন্দ কুমার
শ্রীকৃষ্ণ চৈতন্য প্রভু জীবে দয়া করি
কৃষ্ণ চৈতন্য দয়া করে
রূপ সনাতন পদে দন্তে তৃণ করি
রূপ সনাতন পদে দন্তে তৃণ করে
রূপ সনাতন পদে দন্তে তৃণ করি রূপ সনাতন পদে ভক্তি বিনোদ পড়ে দুহু পদ ধরি কাদিয়া কাদিয়া বলে আমি তো অধম
কাদিয়া কান্দিয়া বলে
কান্দিয়া কাদিয়া বনে আমি তো অধম
কান্দিয়া কান্দিয়া বলে আমি তো অধম
শিখায় শরণাগতি করবে উত্তম
শিখায় শরণাগতি করহে উত্তম
শিখায় শরণাগতি করবে উত্তম
শিখায় শরণাগতি করহে
শ্রীকৃষ্ণ চৈতন্য প্রভু जीवे दया करी
श्री कृष्ण चैतन्या प्रभु जीवे दया करे
सपार्षद शिव धाम सहायवतरी
सपार्षद
शिव धाम सपार्षद शिव धाम सहायवतरी सपार्षद शिव धाम सहायवतरी
श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु जीवे दया करी श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु जीवे दया करे
जय गौर निताय जय गौर निताय गौर निताय जय गौर निताय जय पंचतत जय पंचतत जय जय प्रभुपाद 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 जय प्रभुपाद प्रभुपाद
shared the topic with Bhakti Gauravani Maharaj about Krishna Prema. And yeah, I told Krishna Prema will be my topic. And he was very surprised because this is very elevated topic. And of course, to speak about something means one has some experience. And I don't claim that level of Krishna Prema. This is topmost level in devotional service. For example, if someone has Krishna Prema, upon chanting the holy names, one will cry tears of love of God. And before that, we can understand that there is no real love of God. But actually, this song we just sang is very interesting. I think we should thank Mahanitai Prabhu and our musicians for really wonderful song. Anyone enjoyed it? Okay. So we heard traditional Bengali singing because this is Lord Chaitanya's mercy. He came here and this is what this song is explaining, that he came from his own abode, from the spiritual world. Whenever the Supreme Lord is coming, he is coming with his own abode. So at the moment, we are in the abode of the Lord. Shridham Mayapur is not part of the material world. It's Sviya Dhamma, Shridham Mayapur, we say. It's exact replica of spiritual world. And he came with his associates, Svaprasada, Parishad, this is how they say in Bengal. Sanskrit word is Parishad, and in Bengal they say Parishad, almost the same. And why did Lord Chaitanya came? He came to give everyone very rare gift. And what is the rare gift? Atyanta durlaba prema koribare dan. So he gave everyone a rare gift of love of God. And this is very interesting question. We came in touch with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and now do we have Krishna Prema or not? Let me see show of hands. How many, and I'm not going to raise my hand in either case, not to bewilder you. So how many of you think that we don't have any Krishna Prema? Please raise your hands. Okay. And how many of you think that we do have Krishna Prema? Please raise your hands. Okay. Most of the devotees never raise their hand. Actually, both of the statements are true. We don't have Krishna Prema on the topmost level, but if we got nothing, no Krishna Prema at all, then, you know, what Bhaktivinoda Thakur is talking about. So actually we do have Krishna Prema, because Krishna consciousness, by the mercy of Lord Chaitanya, means we get Krishna Prema. But Srila Prabhupada says this love is not yet mature. He gives example of green mango and ripened mango. And ripened mango is very sweet and very fragrant. But even green mango has some use, right? We can make achar from green mango. First achar, then prachar. And we can understand that if we don't have any Krishna Prema at all, then what are we doing in this movement? Actually, every single devotee in this movement has some degree of Krishna Prema. And then, of course, when we speak about topmost level, it's very rare for someone to have topmost level of Krishna Prema. But let me ask you this question. How many of you like Krishna? Okay, everyone likes Krishna. So that means it's the beginning of Krishna Prema, right? You have deep appreciation for Krishna. You really like Krishna. Any of you can imagine living without Krishna? Yeah, this would be a nightmare. So that means all of us already have attachment to Krishna, which is the first stages of love of Godhead. And it is very interesting. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Shikhaya Sharanagati Bhaktara Pran. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is teaching Sharanagati, which is the sixfold process of surrendering unto Krishna. And this is the process which actually helps us to develop Krishna Prema. And in Chaitanya Charitamrita, it is described by Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Anukulyasya sankalpa pratikulyasya vartanam rakshishyati iti vishvaso god pritve varanam tatha atmanikshapa karpanya sadvida sharanagati. So that there are six levels of surrendering unto Krishna. First one is anukulyasya sankalpa, doing whatever is anukul, whatever is auspicious, and then pratikulyasya vartanam, avoiding doing anything inauspicious. And rakshisyati te vishvaso, taking full shelter of Krishna, taking Krishna as one's protector. And gopritpe varanam tatha, accepting Krishna as the supreme master. Atmanikshepa, full self-surrender, and karpanya, which is humility. But in this song, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur describes it in a different way. He says, danya atmanivedana gop, that he starts with danya, which is humility. So the reverse order. Why? because humility is the most important factor in developing Krishna consciousness. And in relation to Krishna Prema, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explains that those who really have Krishna Prema, they never think that they do. This is the very interesting contradiction. Lord Chaitanya explains, this is Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Lila, chapter 2, text 43. Madhya 2:43. Forgive my Bengali, I'll try to read it. Akaitava Krishna Prema Jena Jambunada Hema Sei Prema Nriloke Na Haya Yadi Haya Tara Yoga Na Haya Tabe Biyoga Biyoga Haile Keha Najiyaya. Pure love for Krishna, just like gold from the Jambu River, does not exist in human society. If it existed, there could be no separation. If separation were there, is there, one could not leave. And then Lord Chaitanya says, my dear friends, I have not the slightest tinge of love of Godhead within my heart. When you see me crying in separation, I'm just falsely exhibiting a demonstration of my great fortune. Indeed, not seeing the beautiful face of Krishna playing his flute, I continue to live my life like an insect without purpose. So even though Lord Chaitanya was crying tears of love of God, but he's explaining that I'm just demonstrating my good fortune, falsely exhibiting a demonstration of my great fortune, but actually I don't have pure love for Krishna. Because if someone has pure love for Krishna, then one will not be able to live in this world in separation from Krishna. And Lord Chaitanya is explaining, I'm living, I'm maintaining my life, so that's the proof that I don't really have pure love of Krishna. And we can understand that this is humility. Lord Chaitanya is exhibiting humility, and where the humility is coming from? Why the devotees have so much humility? Because Krishna is a very humble person, even though it doesn't look like that he is killing many demons and he is ruling and he is doing all these different things, controlling and enjoying. But actually, there are many descriptions how humble Krishna is. Right? When you see, when Krishna was with his friends on the bank of the Yamuna and they were taking lunch, and then Lord Brahma, as we know, he decided to steal the calves, and the coward boys were scared and they said, they shouted Krishna, and Krishna said, don't worry, you don't have to go and search for the calves, I will go and do it myself, which is very interesting. He didn't tell them, I'm the supreme enjoyer and you're all my servants, so you should go and search for the calves. No, he decided to do it himself. And there are many, many other examples of Krishna's humility. For example, when Krishna received Sudama Brahmana in his house, what did he do? He washed his feet and then sprinkled the Charanamrita on his own head. And when there was Rajasuya Yagya of Maharaj Yudhishthir, which position Krishna took? He was washing everyone's feet upon arrival. So we can understand that the Supreme Lord is very humble personality because he is the supreme leader of all men, of all living entities. And it is very interesting, one devotee who has very high position, he is the regional director for Harvard Business School in Southeast Asia, which is covering 10 countries. So he is organizing Harvard Business courses in 10 countries. And he came and he shared the latest results of the research, of Harvard Business Research in leadership. Let me see, how many of you want to be perfect leaders in life? Anyone? You should have this desire, because devotee means one who represents Krishna, the supreme leader. So Krishna Upadesh, Guru Hanataraidesh. This is what Lord Chaitanya says. Wherever you go, whomever you meet, teach them the teachings of Krishna, and in this way become guru and save the people of your land. Right? So this is Lord Chaitanya's order. And therefore, if you don't have a desire to become perfect leader, you should reconsider and develop the desire. And what are the topmost qualities of leaders which are recognized, universally recognized in 21st century? Believe it or not, according to Harvard Business Research, there are two qualities which are the most appreciated in leaders, and these qualities are, first one, humility, and second, compassion. It's amazing how the world is moving towards Krishna conscious model, because we're actually living in the dawn of the golden age. We are 532 years into the golden age of Lord Chaitanya. Everybody knows about it, that it's not Kali Yuga anymore. We are living in the golden age of Lord Chaitanya, and therefore there are so many changes on the planet which help everyone to develop Krishna consciousness. And Krishna is very humble, Lord Chaitanya is very humble, and therefore devotees are also very humble. That's not exactly a very humble way to deal with people, but actually Krishna is doing that just to protect his devotees. Krishna is very humble with his devotees, but then the miscreants who are disturbing the devotees, he is very heavy with them. He is punishing them very heavily. And therefore, humility is the first and foremost quality of an advanced devotee. And the second quality is Atma Nivedana, which is mentioned by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Atma Nivedana means full self-surrender. And Srila Prabhupada explains in Bhagavad Gita in the purport that Atma refers to the body, Atma may refer to the mind, Atma may refer to intelligence, to the material conditioning, false ego, and Atma may refer to the spirit soul also. So whatever we identify ourselves with, that's Atma. And Atma Nivedana means full self-surrender, means everything we have, we dedicate for Krishna. Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains, Manasa deho geho yo kichumora arpinuntuva pade nanda kishora. Oh my Lord, whatever I have, my mind, my body, my house, I dedicate in your service. And so this is very important for all of us. Atmanivedana means full dedication in Krishna service. And it is very easy to engage our body in Krishna service, right? We all know how to do it. But is it easy to engage the mind in Krishna service? How many of you think it is easy to engage the mind? How many of you think it's a bit of a challenge to engage your mind in Krishna service? But this is what it means, Atmanivedana, full self-surrender. And especially when you chant mantra, japa, then this is the opportunity to engage your mind in Krishna. And engage your intelligence as well. Actually, intelligence can control the mind. And how do we do that? How do we engage our mind and intelligence? Because this is what Krishna really recommends in Bhagavad Gita. Man mana bhav mad bhakto madhya jimam namaskuru. By taking responsibility for service in Krishna consciousness and acting in Krishna's service according to our nature. So these are the two important factors. How do we engage our mind and intelligence? Because mind is connected to emotions, and emotions are connected to relationships, and intelligence is connected to acting according to our nature. Because if we act in Krishna's service using our nature, and this is one of the key messages of Bhagavad Gita, Shyamsva dharma vigunan para dharma tsanushtitat, that it's much better to be engaged according to your nature, do your duty rather than imitating somebody else. And if you are engaged in this way, you can easily control your intelligence by active engagement in devotional service. So this is Atmanivedana. And in all respects, who is the best example for us? Srila Prabhupada. That he showed the best example how to be fully engaged in devotional service. And coming back to... No, actually we will continue. That God Prithvai Bharana the third aspect of Sharanagati is to accept Krishna as one's maintainer. And it's not very hard, because we can see by practical experience that we may make effort, we may endeavor in a certain ways, but the results do not really depend on us, right? Whether we will get results or not, whom it depends on? Anyone knows whom the results depend on? Krishna, yes, let's say it all together and very loud. Whom results depend on?
Krishna.
Yes, all results depend on Krishna. And therefore, it's quite easy for us to recognize that Krishna is the Supreme Master. Because if he wants, he will give the results. And if he doesn't want, he will not give the results. How many of you had experience of making a lot of effort in order to get the result, but then not getting any result you expected? Anyone had the experience? Okay. And how many of you had the experience of not really making much effort, but then getting results as Krishna's causeless mercy? Okay. So we all have this experience. And so therefore, our efforts and results, they are not really connected so much. But Maya, illusory energy, convinces us that our efforts are connected to the results. Okay, so let's do something practical. Maybe you can turn to the devotee next to you and share one of the experiences, whether you endeavored a lot and you didn't get any results you expected, or you haven't made any effort and then by Krishna's mercy you got bigger result than you expected. Everyone had one or the other experience? Yes? Okay. So maybe you can share with each other just for 5 minutes. What happened to you? Yeah, turn to the devotee next to you and tell them, once I had this experience. Because this is practical philosophy, not theory. This is the strength in Krishna consciousness, that you chant Hare Krishna and then Krishna manifests in your life. Okay? So 5 minutes. Share with the devotee next to you your experiences of Krishna being the master, the maintainer. I hope everyone found at least one episode in your life. Of course, in our lives it might not happen in a big way, because we are not big devotees yet, but in big devotees' lives it's happening in a big way. Like Srila Prabhupada, for example. Srila Prabhupada made so much effort to succeed in his business, right? All his youth he spent trying to make money, and he didn't plan to make money for himself. He wanted to help his spiritual master with his preaching mission. And it was also predicted that he will become one of the wealthiest men in India. And astrology is the bona fide Vedic science. So Srila Prabhupada fully trusted it and he tried to make money. Was he successful? Yeah. He couldn't make much. And then he was getting older and older, and his spiritual master was telling him, you have to preach in English. And Prabhupada was thinking, okay, I can preach, but what about money? What about becoming one of the wealthiest men in India? How come that this prediction never gets fulfilled? So he was trying to combine making business and doing some preaching, publishing books. And at some point, this was completely incompatible, and he was living in Vrindavan. And then the news came that his business collapsed. And how did Srila Prabhupada receive this news? With joy. Finally, you know, I don't have to worry about this failing business. He actually laughed. He said, Krishna is always the same. Yasyaham anugrinami harishitad danam shanai. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, in Srimad Bhagavatam, in his conversation with Maharaj Yudhishthir, that my first and foremost mercy to my devotee is that I'm taking away all his riches. Let's see, anyone had this experience? Krishna taking away all your money? Okay, not many, because it's rare mercy of Krishna. And Srila Prabhupada had this experience, and he was happy. He was thinking, thanks Krishna, now I'm free to do whatever I want for my spiritual master. I don't have to worry about business. And then he started preparing, and he went to America, and he, you know, the rest is history, how he successfully preached, and his, the distribution of his books became very, very successful. And people were coming forward and supporting Srila Prabhupada financially. He was getting a lot of donations, and it was all his. It was his society, and it still is his society, and all the money belonged to Srila Prabhupada. And therefore, for this reason, the famous American news company, CNN, made an analysis of 10 people, special people, in the 20th century, who became extremely wealthy, even though they've started their business very late in life. They calculated after 50. And so, who was the oldest man on the list? Srila Prabhupada. So, Prabhupada was first in the 20th century in this category. He started after 70, and he got literally billions of dollars for serving Krishna. He was getting so much, devotees couldn't even spend it all. When Srila Prabhupada was already in Vrindavan, preparing to leave his body, Tamal Krishna Maharaj came and he said, just in the past month, we've got more than $2 million of income, and we don't know what to do with this money. We have nowhere to spend it. And Prabhupada said, don't keep. If you cannot spend it yourself, send it to some developing country, backward country. He said, let them spend it. Don't keep. Just use it for Krishna. So Srila Prabhupada left this world being one of the richest men, not only in India, but in the whole world. So the prediction came true. But amazingly enough, it came true when Srila Prabhupada stopped making effort to get money. He just focused on preaching, and then Krishna gave him everything. So this is the example. Therefore, Gaura Mohan Deh, Srila Prabhupada's father, used to tell him, Krishna has thousands of hands. Well, mostly we see Krishna with two hands, but actually Krishna has unlimited hands because he is the Supreme Lord. You can see Nrsimha Dev in the temple, he has many hands. And Gaura Mohan Deh was saying, Krishna has thousands of hands, and if he wants to take something away from you, what can you hold back with your two hands? It's hopeless. And if Krishna wants to give something to you, how much you can hold with your two little hands, right? And so therefore, devotee is fully surrendered unto Krishna. Whatever Krishna wants to take away, devotee doesn't mind. Why? Why devotee is happy even if Krishna is taking something away from him? Why Srila Prabhupada was happy when Krishna took away everything? His family, his business, his income, everything. And he was happy. Because pure devotee understands, Krishna is my best well-wisher. Suhridam sarabhutanam. And Krishna will never take anything away if he does not plan to give me something better. So Prabhupada was fully confident, and we should be also very confident about it. How many of you had this experience? That Krishna was taking something away from you, and you were like not very happy at the moment, but then because of that situation you've got something better. Anyone had this experience? Yeah, we can see that it works in the same way in the life of Srila Prabhupada and other great devotees, and it works in the same way in our lives. Maybe the scale and the level is different, but the principles are the same. We are holding something which we don't really need, but we think we need it. And so Krishna is thinking, no, this is a mistake. He or she does not need this thing, so let me take it away. And then we cry, oh, what happened, Krishna? And then Krishna says, okay, I'll give you something better. Devotees are fully trusting Krishna. Because Krishna is the one who is maintaining and protecting the devotees. And this is the fourth item of Sharanagati, Krishna's protection. Again, it's the same thing. We cannot protect ourselves, but Krishna can protect us. How many of you had experience that Krishna is protecting you in your life, in most dangerous situations? Of course, we know so many examples of in Srila Prabhupada's life how Krishna protected him. On the ship, he got two heart attacks, and Krishna personally came and he treated Srila Prabhupada so nicely that upon arrival to America, he didn't even have to go to hospital. He just went straight to preach, right? So Krishna is the best doctor. And there were so many dangerous situations in Prabhupada's life, and Krishna fully protected him. But it doesn't mean that we have to test how much Krishna will protect me and get ourselves into dangerous situations. For example, in South Africa, the speed limit, they have very nice roads. Any of you from here, in here from South Africa? They have very nice roads, very smooth roads, and so the speed limit is 120 kilometers per hour. But you can drive even faster if you want. But then one senior devotee, Kadamakanda Maharaj, he says, if you drive faster than 120 kilometers per hour, Krishna leaves your car, right? Because this is the limit Krishna put. So if you break the limit, Krishna will not protect you. And many devotees had this experience that Krishna can protect, but he doesn't want us to risk unnecessarily. There was one devotee in Russia, and he bought a very nice car, and he took deity of Nrsimhadev and placed this deity in the car, and he was thinking, because Nrsimhadev is with me, I can do whatever I want. I can drive any speed. And he was driving very fast, breaking all the speed limits, and he was thinking Nrsimhadev will protect him. And then at some point he lost control of the steering wheel and he went off the road. And the car went, what do you call it, upside down a few times. Luckily, it was actually a very safe car. And so he was fastened and he survived and he didn't even had much damage. Actually, there was nothing. But the car was completely finished. The car was beyond any repair. And so he got out of the car and the car was just, you know, piece of junk metal. And he was thinking, oh, this is very good. Krishna didn't protect my car, but at least he protected me. And where is my Nrsimhadev? And Nrsimhadev was not in the car. And he was searching for him everywhere. And Nrsimhadev just disappeared. So, and he learned a very good lesson that, yes, Krishna is protecting, but we cannot abuse Krishna's shelter, Krishna's protection. So this is very important. Therefore, Srila Prabhupada was saying that we have to surrender to Krishna, but we should not surrender our intelligence or switch off our intelligence. We have to still be responsible, act responsibly, in Krishna's service, not abuse Krishna's mercy upon us. Krishna definitely loves us all, first of all, because we are living entities, and the best of all living entities are human beings, and the best of all human beings are devotees of Krishna. So that's why Krishna is very merciful to all the devotees. How many of you had experienced that? Krishna is very, very merciful to you. Okay. But we should not abuse Krishna's mercy. Because Krishna is the person and he understands if we abuse his mercy, he may not give us any more just to teach us a lesson. And so surrendering unto Krishna means whatever Krishna is giving, we're using for him, but we should not abuse his mercy. So we can maybe take questions, if anyone has questions. We have microphone for the devotees. Okay. Microphone.
Hello? Yeah. My question is just about humility and any tips you have to practice.
Humility and how to practice humility?
Yes.
Okay, well, this is a very good question. We have something which is called Vaishnava etiquette, and if we fully practice Vaishnava etiquette, that's the best way to develop humility. For example, we're bowing down to devotees, to Krishna, to the deities, to Tulsi, to so many personalities, right? Especially here in Mayapur, it's like non-stop bowing down. Right? Sometimes devotees think, I might just keep lying in Dandavat on the road because it's like so many times going up and down. But it helps us to develop humility. And therefore, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that Vaishnava etiquette is the ornament of the devotee, that the best devotee is always very strict in following Vaishnava etiquette. So that's the best way for us to develop humility. And Srila Prabhupada was teaching his disciples. Of course, he was not interested in worship. This is not why he came to the West, but he knew that for devotees it is important. And in the early days, he introduced them to the idea of bowing down to the spiritual master. So devotees were doing that. But one devotee was saying, I don't like to bow down. One early disciple. And he said, Srila Prabhupada, I don't like to bow down, so do I have to bow down? And Prabhupada said, yeah, it's good for you. And you can just experiment. Let's make an experiment. You bow down now and you see how you feel. And the devotee became intrigued. He said, okay, I never bowed down to Srila Prabhupada, let me try. And so he bowed down and he stood up with a big smile. And Srila Prabhupada said, so how do you feel? The devotee said, I feel very happy now. So because he got Krishna's mercy. So if we follow Krishna's rules, of behavior, culture, Krishna becomes very pleased. And if Krishna becomes very pleased, we become very happy also. So this is the way to develop our humility, by following Vaishnava culture. And especially here in Mayapur, we have so many amazing cultured Gaudiya Vaishnavas, Bengali Vaishnavas, who have very high level of culture. And sometimes it's even hard to accept, like, few devotees who are driving Totos around. And so sometimes I'm asking for a ride, and they refuse to take any money. And it's really hard for me to convince them to take something, because I know this is how they maintain themselves. This is important for them. But they say, no, I'm Grihastha, you are sannyasi, I'm not taking any money from you. And I had one experience. I decided to force one devotee. I gave him 50 rupees, put this 50 rupees in his pocket. He was saying, no, no, I don't want any money. I put this 50 rupees. He bowed down to me, he pulled out 100 rupees, he said, this is donation for you. And ran away. So very, very sincere and very humble devotees. And this is the advantage of being in a holy place, because there are so many holy people in here. And holy people doesn't mean someone very, very prominent. Some very simple devotee sweeping the street or driving Toto or doing some simple service in the temple can actually be very great devotee. We don't know. And in fact, the greater the devotee is, the more humble he is. And by associating with those devotees, we can actually understand what is Krishna consciousness and what is Vaishnava etiquette, what is Vaishnava behavior. Thank you. Good question. Anybody else? Yes, microphone. Yeah.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you very much for your enlightening session. Maharaj, you told the effort and result. So there is no direct relationship or connection between this. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, Krishna is the result giver.
Yes.
So, but at the same time, we get this insight that we have to effort to please him or to preach about his message. Mm-hmm. Then when should we understand, okay, this is extra endeavor and this is sufficient endeavor, mm-hmm. like the effort, how we should understand that this is bona fide?
Yes. So, normal understanding is that we make an effort to get the result. So this is called karma yoga, or maybe karma kanda even. Karmic activity for the result. Devotees are not acting for the result. What do they want? by their activity to please Krishna. To please Krishna, to please Guru, and please Vaishnavas. And Krishna, Guru, and Vaishnavas are not expecting physical results. What they want our effort. Because effort is purifying us. It's like Srila Prabhupada was telling a very funny story about Gopalban. How Gopalban was making a garland from one edible flower. I think it's bakul flower, if anyone heard the story. Anyway, one type of flower which you can actually cook and eat. And so he was making this garland from these flowers, edible flowers. And a friend came to him and he said, Gopal, what are you doing? He said, I'm making garland for Krishna. And I will offer this garland to Krishna. And then his friend said, but are you sure that Krishna will accept this kind of garland? And Gopal said, I'm not sure. Maybe he will not accept. But if he will not accept, what will you do? Then I'll cook these flowers and I'll eat them. So it is like that. Devotee is always ready for anything, expecting the unexpected. That's the best philosophy in life. Because material world, you can never be sure what the results will be, but we have to continue to endeavor. We are acting according to the instructions of Krishna, Guru, and Vaishnavas for their pleasure. They want us to do something, and our duty is to try. Whether we get the results or not, the most important result is that Krishna is pleased. And therefore, devotees always have not only plan A, but plan B, C, D, F, G, H, etc. Even plan Z. So, they are ready for anything. And this is the best way that I'm making an effort, but then it's up to Krishna what he will reciprocate, but it does not mean that I'll stop making the effort. And ultimately, I will achieve the result. We can see Prabhupada, he got the instruction from his spiritual master, and he was endeavoring for so many years, and he was not getting any results. But he never gave up. He continued. And he achieved greater result than anyone could imagine. So that's the best model of activity. Because if Srila Prabhupada would be attached to the result, he wouldn't be able to endeavor for so long. Because you endeavoring 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, no result. What will happen? Frustration, right? But Srila Prabhupada was not frustrated because he knew that endeavor in itself is the most important thing. And I may not get result in this life at all. I may get result in my next life. Or in 10 lifetimes, or in 100 lifetimes. Because I'm doing this for Krishna. So this is the devotee's mentality. Whatever Krishna will arrange is the best arrangement. And I will accept whatever happens. Yes? Thank you. We had a question here. Yes. Someone can pass the microphone.
Asking about, you were talking about that research in Harvard Business School.
Yeah.
So he's saying that that research was based on the personal income or personal achievement. Actually, when they counted money, he says that they took into consideration the income of the whole society, not personal money of Srila Prabhupada. So his question is, why was he included in that list?
Well, because Prabhupada was included in the list of the wealthiest people who achieved success despite of the late start, because legally everything belonged to Srila Prabhupada. It was kind of his business. ISKCON was even incorporated in New York, right? It was, and you can say, it is spiritual corporation. And book distribution is like business, right? Money-making activity, restaurants, and all other programs. They were yielding good results financially. And everything belonged to Srila Prabhupada, and still belongs to Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada still owns everything. Why? Because he never wanted anything for himself. Once Srila Prabhupada said, talking to the students, to the disciples, what is the difference between me and six Goswamis? Because six Goswamis were traveling and building temples and establishing deity worship. Six Goswamis were writing books and distributing books. They were teaching, they were preaching. They were living very austere and renounced lifestyle. So, any difference between me and six Goswamis? And one disciple said, no difference. You are also like six Goswami, one of the, or seventh Goswami. And Prabhupada said, no, there is a very big difference between me and six Goswamis, because six Goswamis stayed under different trees every night. And I'm staying in different palaces every night. And those who have been to the Western countries would know what we're talking about, like Los Angeles, Hawaii, London, Melbourne, and many other places have palatial apartments for Srila Prabhupada. And so he was basically flying from one country to the other, from one place to the other, and he was staying in a very palatial places. And of course, so many people to serve, etc. So it's like royal lifestyle. But the most amazing thing was that Srila Prabhupada never changed. He never changed his lifestyle. He lived exactly the same lifestyle, very regulated and very simple and austere lifestyle. He lived when he had nothing. So, and his lifestyle never changed, even after he got everything. Because he knew, Krishna gave me all this opulence for his service, not for my enjoyment. And that's why Krishna gave him so much. And why Krishna took away everything in the first place, because he had so much more for him in store. And he didn't want him to be attached to this failing business. He wanted him to have the whole world. Yes? Answering the question?
So am I correct to, if I understand that if we use for our own self ISKCON's property or ISKCON's financial resources, everything will be destroyed or ruined?
Oh yes, of course. If we start using anything Krishna gave for our sense gratification, then this is recipe for disaster. We're going to lose everything. And unfortunately, we have these examples also, that sometimes devotees become forgetful, who gave them all the opportunities in life and what was the purpose, and then they start enjoying and then they lose everything. And Srila Prabhupada's example is very important because he showed how to use everything in Krishna's service. Very interesting example when he purchased land in Vrindavan and he paid very big amount of money, wrote a check for, you know, like tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars. And then he was asking, so how do you deliver this check? And the devotee said, we can send it through post or bring it physically by rickshaw. So sending it through post will be maybe 2 rupees, and if you take, or maybe 10 rupees, and if you take rickshaw it will be 5 rupees. Prabhupada said, okay, rickshaw is cheaper, so take it by rickshaw. You know, someone who has hundreds of thousands and millions and he's thinking about 5 rupees, where is the logic? But logic is very simple. Srila Prabhupada knew, this is not my money, so this is Krishna's money. Therefore, I have to be very, very careful in spending even 1 rupee or even 1 paisa of Krishna's money. Hare Krishna. Last question before we break. And tomorrow we're going to be speaking about the most important aspect of Krishna consciousness, which is compassion, and how compassion of Lord Chaitanya and his followers manifest, and how can we follow in their footsteps. Okay, so last chance, if anyone has question, then, okay, last one, and then we'll break for lunch.
Maharaj, you mentioned that intelligence acts according to one's nature. That is the key message of Bhagavad Gita. So how to understand like one's nature? I mean, you know, how much necessary it is to understand nature?
How to understand our nature?
And actually, is it necessary to understand nature, or we keep on serving Krishna under the order of spiritual master, then that is sufficient? Or yeah. should we make any endeavor to understand our Swadharma or something like that?
Well, if we act according to our nature, two things happening. First of all, we gain good results. And second of all, we have inspiration. And third of all, we really feel that this is my mission in life. This is what I was born for. And the best example again is Arjuna. He was born as a Kshatriya, and he was very good in archery. And you can see from Mahabharata that Arjuna was so excited to practice archery. He wanted to become the best archer on the planet. And Gudakesh, we know, he got this name because at some point he started practicing archery day and night, non-stop, right? Because he was so enthusiastic about it. And so he had this nature, and in the circumstances he wanted to shift to Brahminical mode in order to avoid responsibility, acting according to his nature, but Krishna told him, no, I gave you this nature, I want you to use it for my service.
This has to be explicitly verified by the spiritual master that what I am thinking is to be my nature is my nature, or is it my my mind's whimsical, something like that?
So Prabhupada mentions that the expertise of the spiritual master is to engage disciple according to the propensity. Propensity means nature. So this is one of the duties of a spiritual master, to see what is the nature of the disciple and engage accordingly. All right? Hare Krishna. Thank you all very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Samaveta Bhakta Vrinda ki jai. Gaur Premanande.
Do you like our ad-free videos? Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.